Hello everyone, welcome to the presentation Chasing the Digital Pirates, Unveiling the Container Threats. My name is Tejas Girme. Today I am going to talk about the threats targeting Docker containers. The takeaway for the audience will be that they will have a complete understanding about the techniques used by these threats and understanding about the different strategies that can be implemented to protect against them. A brief intro about me. Currently, I am working as a senior malware researcher in Qualys. I have experience of more than 7 years in malware analysis, reverse engineering, writing signatures and detections, and writing automations. Prior to Qualys, I have worked in Quickel Technologies. I would like to share a word of thanks to my teammate Ali Attari, who has given a significant contribution for this presentation. Agenda for the presentation is that we will start a brief overview about the containers. Then we will see why there is a need to focus on runtime security. Next, we will have a deep dive into a couple of case studies in the section Chasing the Pirates. Then we will see the techniques from the view of MITRE ATT&CK framework. Further, we will discuss about the strategies that can be built to protect against these threats, and finally we will conclude with the presentation. Container technology has gained enormous popularity in past couple of years. This is due to the build ship run mechanism it uses for development, shipment and deployment of applications. Docker images can be used to package the applications and its dependencies all together in a single unit using a Docker file. This Docker file can be further built to convert it into a Docker image which is shipped to Docker registries. Docker registries are nothing but the public or private repositories where the images can be shared. The end user who intends to use these images can pull them from the registries and execute them into their host system. The container is a running instance of the Docker image which executes applications in an isolated environment. Docker daemon is a resident process that manages the execution of a container, and it communicates over API ports 2375, 2376 and 2377. Enterprises have adopted to this technology and started relying on it to deliver the applications and software. Let's see why there is a need to focus on runtime security. Traditional solutions rely to scan Docker files to find traces of malicious code. Here, they may scan to search for exposed ports, outdated or vulnerable applications, misconfigurations due to such applications, presence of some malicious executable code, etc. So after scanning, if the Docker file is observed to be clean, it does not ensure that it will never execute a malicious code inside the container. What if an attacker gets an access to container and downloads and executes a malicious component inside it? What if attacker somehow get access via publicly exposed ports, maybe Docker daemon API ports or application specific ports, and further overrides the entry point to execute a malicious shell script which further download malicious components? This shows us that it's important to have a solution in place which monitors the behavior of the executables inside the containers, and hence there is a need to have a runtime security in place. Now we will deep dive into a couple of case studies in the section Chasing the Pirates. The first case study is LibMiner. LibMiner executes in multiple stages and downloads several components during the course of execution. It targets the containers executing Redis server. Let's understand the attack flow first. The attack initiates from container entry point, which executes a shell script. This shell script further downloads another shell script which sets the environment for execution of LibMiner and downloads and executes a LibMiner executable. LibMiner is a UPX-backed ELF file which is modular in nature and has several functions written to perform individual tasks. While performing these tasks, it downloads several components and all these components except ELF file are in encoded form, and this can be decoded by applying base64 followed by Caesar cipher. The execution of LibMiner proceeds in an infinite loop and hence executes the functions repetitively. So once the execution is complete in single container, then it looks forward to target other containers in network, where it looks for containers having Redis server port exposed. If found, then it deploys a LibMiner script inside it for execution. Let's have a look at the techniques used by LibMiner. Initial access it obtained from a entry point, container entry point, it executes a script to schedule a cron job for execution. This cron job ensures the execution, download and execution of LibMiner components. It also looks to create a cron job on the host machine via mount drive. This observes to be an attempt to expand the scope of execution of LibMiner from container to host machine. For persistence, it executes boot monitor function, which downloads the component that is a shell script. This shell script is nothing but this shell script executes and downloads LibMiner component and executes it. This shell script is placed in init directory and registered to execute on startup. The same component is also placed in user bin directory and registered to execute as a systemd service. It downloads the mining components and executes them to initiate mining activity inside the victim container. The components include XMRI executable and a configuration file. On initiating the mining, the miner connects to minexml.com mining pool and generates revenue for given wallet address. From the graph, it's visible that the active mining was seen to the wallet address from July 2019 to December 2019. For evading the detection and disguising its execution, it uses two functions. The change PID function forks the child process and exits the parent process, where it executes with changed PID. For change name, it has a predefined list of file names that are the names of files of the operating system. It modifies the first argument from the arguments array and modifies the name of the executing binary. Apart from this, it uses anti-analysis techniques, where it makes a file immutable, which makes it difficult for rename, modification, and deletion of file. And the typed commands on the terminal are hidden. For lateral movement, it downloads a Python script via function Redis. This Python script prepares the list of IPs to be targeted by accessing the subnet IP information. Then for the each IP, it makes a connection via Python Redis packages over port 6379. If the connection is successful, then it dumps a file in cron job location, which contains the code to execute a LibMiner shell script. Next, we will have a look at a case study named Big Bot Pain Miner. This also executes in multiple stages and have several components that it fetches during the execution. Big Bot Pain term might some people might relate this term Big Bot Pain to a previous campaign which was active a couple of years ago. This was associated with Lizard Squad and Mirai. From our analysis of the current threat, Big Bot Pain Miner, we observe that it has no relation with the earlier campaign, and here the Big Bot Pain name is derived from the domain that it uses. This is a website which allows sharing of components publicly in an anonymous way. All the components used by this threat are hosted on this Big Bot Pain domain. Let's understand the attack flow. The attack initiates from a container endpoint which executes a shell script to download Alduro script. Alduro script is termed by us as a Big Bot Pain Miner or BBP Miner. This is the core module which executes in this thread, and it is also modular in nature. It has several functions written to perform individual tasks, and further it downloads several components while its execution. The first component it downloads is a backdoor which connects to attacker's CNC server and allows attacker to control the execution of Big Bot Pain Miner. Next, it downloads the mining components and executes them to initiate mining in the victim container. The next component it downloads ensures that the miners execute in an uninterrupted way. Once the installation is complete in a single container, then it looks to move laterally and infect other containers. For this, it downloads a set of files and additional components like Maskin. It prepares a list of IP addresses where Docker daemon ports are exposed publicly, and then further looks to connect them and deploy a Big Bot Pain Miner Alduro script inside those containers. Now let's have a look at techniques used by Big Bot Pain Miner. First, it installs the backdoor and opens the CNC connections with attacker's CNC server on port 81. Attacker uses below set of commands to control the execution in the victim container. From the decompiled code of a backdoor, we observe that it has a close resemblance with the publicly available source code of QBot malware. Big Bot Pain Miner downloads a set of files and execute them to initiate mining on the victim container. Here it downloads XMRIC miner and a configuration JSON file which has the information of the mining tool, mining domain where it connects, which is hashwall.pro, and the mentioned wallet address. From the stats, this thread generated a revenue of $7 per day, and this threat was actively generating the revenue from 1 December 2019 till end of Jan 2020. For persistence, it schedules a cron job to execute 3 shell scripts. First one is the Big Bot Pain Miner. Second one is the cessa.txt, which ensures a seamless execution, and third one downloads the mining components. For evading the detection, it performs following operations, where it looks for the traces of execution of competing miner components, and if found, it kills all of them. Next, it disables the policy enforcement tools like SE Linux. It updates the host file to block the network connections done by the competing miners to their mining pools. Also blocks the network connections for the security tools if any present. For executing with escalated privileges, it creates a user and add it to sudoers group. Further, it updates the SSD login configuration to permit root login. For lateral movement, it downloads a set of files that contains the IP subnets. IP subnets either are location specific or cloud hosting service, cloud service hosting service, or specific to certain cloud service providers. Further, it downloads additional components like Mascan that scans the IP subnets to identify if any of the IP has container which has Docker daemon ports exposed. If found, then it prepares the list of such IP address and then connect to them over Docker daemon API ports using docker minus h command. If the connection is successful, then it deploys a bigbot pen minus script inside that container and executes it. It uses one more technique for lateral movement where it that is SSH hijacking. Here it it modifies the authorized keys file and adds the key into it. Then it executes the SSH command to deploy the bigbot pin miner into the target container. The information needed for as a parameter for SSH command is obtained by scanning bash history files, host files, known host file, and SSH config file. To have the recap of the techniques that we have seen so far used by the threads, we have seen that initial access is obtained either by exposed Docker daemon API ports or exposed application specific ports. It uses for execution and persistence, it uses scheduled cron jobs, it uses system services, init directories are used for startup. For escalating the privileges, it creates a user and assigns privileges to it. For defense evasion, it encodes. It uses encoding over the components. It uses impaired defenses where it disables the security enforcement tools. It obtains the necessary keys and credentials by scanning the files. For discovering the information, it scans the IPs, IP list. It scans for open port. It scans the processes for finding the traces of competing miners. It scans the file system to identify the presence of certain security tool. For lateral movement, it makes use of commands like docker minus h, techniques like SSH hijacking, and finally it looks to deploy the payload, which is a crypto miner that is known for hijacking the CPU resources. To stay protected from threats, first, we will look upon the mitigation techniques that can help us to reduce the impact of threat. For this, it's important that containers should have the applications that are updated. They should not execute a vulnerable applications and packages inside it. It's important that the Docker images are pulled from authenticated and trusted sources. Attackers will always look to access the containers, and for this it will always look if any port is publicly exposed, whether Docker daemon API port or application specific port. So it's important that we restrict access to such ports. It's important that we should disable SSH if not required at all to avoid the usage of SSH hijacking technique for lateral movement. The resources, there should be an access control applied through a policy enforcement tools to avoid to there should be policies imposed using policy enforcement tool to manage the access to the resources like sensitive files. The threat will always look to escape from container to the host system, and mounted drives are one of the channels for that. So it's important that drives or folders from host machine should be mounted with read-only privileges. No root privilege for containers. This is important so that container should never execute with root privileges. That is, that will avoid access to sensitive files inside the containers. Apart from having a techniques, apart from mitigation techniques that we have seen, it's important to have a solution in place that monitors the behavior inside the container to identify the activity done by the unknown threats. For this, it's important to monitor the persistence locations like scheduled jobs, init directories, system services, bash rc file, etc. It's important that we monitor the network behavior inside the container to identify what domains are connected, what IP addresses are connected, what ports are exposed, what components are being downloaded inside container. So it's also important to scan the processes frequently to identify if there is attempt from any process to disable the policy enforcement tools, if there is process executing with extreme high CPU usage, or if there is process process that is making an attempt to create a new user and trying to access the sensitive files to assign higher privileges for user to execute. So that's all about how we can identify the suspicious activity or malicious activity inside the container. Concluding with the presentation, what we have is, it is clear that crypto miner remains to be a prominent threat for containers and even a mainstream revenue source for the attackers. Here the threats that are seen recently have the capabilities to protect the execution of crypto miner, where the threats look for uninterrupted, continuous and seamless execution of crypto miners. They also have capabilities to move laterally across the network, in the network, from containers to host, etc. The motive behind this is to spread across the network to execute maximum instances of the crypto miners to generate more and more revenue for the attacker. From defense point of view, the hardening of container can help to reduce the attack surface for the threats, and runtime security can help to identify the suspicious or malicious activity by unknown or untrusted by unknown threats inside the containers, and all together these solutions can play a crucial role for the all-round security of containers. Thank you.